And we return to last night's debate by looking more closely at some of the debatable arguments made by both candidates and sorting through the rhetoric. Ray Suarez picks up that part of the story.
The confrontations in last night's debate came early and often, with charges and denials flying. So we spent part of this day examining the candidates' statements for context and contradictions on three key issues.
First, Libya and the attack that killed the U.S. ambassador and three other Americans on September 11th. President Obama and Mitt Romney sparred heatedly over whether the administration was honest about what happened. The president strongly criticized Romney's initial response to the attack.
While we were still dealing with our diplomats being threatened, Governor Romney put out a press release trying to make political points. And that's not how a commander-in-chief operates. You don't turn national security into a political issue, certainly not right when it's happening.
Romney fired back that the president's team blamed the attack on an anti-Muslim video, even after they knew it wasn't so.
It was a terrorist attack, and it took a long time for that to be told to the American people. Whether there was some misleading or instead whether we just didn't know what happened, I think you have to ask yourself, why didn't we know 5 days later when the ambassador to the United Nations went on TV to say that this was a demonstration? How could we have not known?
That was a reference to Ambassador Susan Rice's statement of September 16th.
Our current assessment is that what happened in Benghazi was in fact initially a spontaneous reaction to what had just transpired hours before in Cairo, almost a copycat of the demonstrations against our facility in Cairo, which were prompted, of course, by the video.
State Department officials said last week they never believed the video had caused the attack. The president said last night the attack is still under investigation, but insisted there was no attempt to deceive.
The day after the attack, Governor, I stood in the Rose Garden and I told the American people and the world that we are going to find out exactly what happened, that this was an act of terror, and the suggestion that anybody in my team, whether the Secretary of State, our UN ambassador, anybody on my team would play politics or mislead when we've lost four of our own, Governor, is offensive.
And that led to this exchange, Governor, ultimately involving moderator Candy Crowley.
I think it's interesting. The president just said something which is that on the day after the attack, he went to the Rose Garden and said that this was an act of terror.
That's what I said.
You said in the Rose Garden, the day after the attack, it was an act of terror. It was not a spontaneous demonstration. I want to make sure we get that for the record, because it took the president 14 days before he called the attack in Benghazi an act of terror.
Get the transcript.
He did, in fact, sir. So let me call it an act of terror.
Can you say that a little louder, Candy?
He did call it an act of terror. It did as well take 2 weeks or so for the whole idea of there being a riot out there about this tape to come out. You're correct about that.
According to the White House transcript, Mr. Obama said the following on September 12th. No acts of terror will ever shake the resolve of this great nation, alter that character, or eclipse the light of the values that we stand for. The 2 weeks later reference was to a statement by White House Press Secretary Jay Carney. On September 26th, he said, for the first time, it is certainly the president's view that it was a terrorist attack. As contentious as the Libya discussion was last night, the exchanges over energy policy proved equally sharp. The Republican nominee pointed to the price of gasoline as evidence of presidential failure.
The proof of whether a strategy is working or not is what the price is that you're paying at the pump. If you're paying less than you paid a year or two ago, why then the strategy is working. But you're paying more. When the president took office, the price of gasoline here in Nassau County was about $1.86 a gallon. Now it's $4 a gallon.
But President Obama warned that promises of lower gas prices are not risk-free.
Think about what the governor just said. He said, when I took office, the price of gasoline was $1.80, $1.86. Why is that? Because the economy was on the verge of collapse. Because we were about to go through the worst recession since the Great Depression. As a consequence of some of the same policies that Governor Romney is now promoting. So It's conceivable that Governor Romney could bring down gas prices, because with his policies, we might be back in that same mess.
One of those watching that back and forth, as well as the argument over drilling on federal land, was Juliette Alperin, a national environmental reporter with The Washington Post.
Obama did make a legitimate point that we were in the depths of the recession worldwide, and so there was a reduction in demand which led to a lower gas price.
Alperin said Romney's charge that production fell during the president's tenure was partly correct, but that was primarily for a time after the Gulf oil spill. Overall,
the first 3 years of the Obama administration has seen an increase in both oil and gas production on public lands compared to the last 3 years of the Bush administration. You've seen an uptick of 13% in terms of oil production, 6% in terms of natural gas production. So there actually has not been a fall off over the course of his administration. That said, it is true that the Romney administration, if elected, would pursue policies that are more favorable to oil and gas companies and could open up areas for production which the Obama administration has closed off. So you could see an expansion in oil and gas exploration in the United States. That's pretty clear. Whether that would shift the price at the pump remains unclear.
On another pocketbook issue, tax cuts, the two men also presented sharply competing claims. Governor Romney insisted he can cut marginal tax rates across the board by 20%. While limiting some deductions and loopholes that would be both revenue neutral and benefit the middle class.
Why am I lowering taxes on the middle class? Because under the last 4 years, they've been buried. And I want to help people in the middle class. And I will not, under any circumstances, reduce the share that's being paid by the highest income taxpayers. And I will not, under any circumstances, increase taxes on the middle class. The president's spending, the president's borrowing, will cause this nation to have to raise taxes on the American people, not just at the high end.
But the president pointed to analyses that found Romney's initial tax proposals could cost nearly $5 trillion over 10 years. That, he argued, did not take into account at least $2 trillion more in spending and other tax proposals from Romney.
Governor Romney was a very successful investor. If somebody came to you, Governor, with a plan that said, here, I want to spend $7 or $8 trillion, and we're going to pay for it, but we can't tell you until maybe after the election how we're going to do it, you wouldn't have taken such a sketchy deal, and neither should you, the American people, because the math doesn't add up.
Today we caught up with Donald Marin of the Bipartisan Tax Policy Center. He's an author of one of the analyses quoted by the president and others.
Governor Romney has laid out four or five different principles that he'd like to accomplish in his tax reform. And what our study concludes is that it's not possible to accomplish all of them. If he's willing to compromise in one dimension, right, allow the deficit to be bigger or raise taxes on capital gains and dividends, it may be possible. Someone may be able to put forward a plan that would do it. But thus far, we haven't seen one.
For his part, Governor Romney has said there are six studies that show he can fulfill his tax cut pledges. But while some of those analyses suggest Romney's plan might be plausible under certain conditions not acknowledged by the governor, four of them are either op-ed columns or online posts written by conservative economists.
You can watch the entire debate on our homepage, or if you choose, 8 minutes of highlights. We posted the most memorable exchanges to give you a chance to vote on how the candidates performed. Plus, you can watch our After Hours live stream conversation where political editor Christina Bellantoni and Hari Srinivasan answered the questions you asked on Twitter and Facebook.